So during the Galactic Civil War, the Empire and the Rebellion used very different strategies and tactics on the battlefield. So I figured today we'll take a look at some of the tactics, specifically the ones used by the Rebel Alliance during the conflict, and how they really represented the real differences between the two factions. I'm Colin, and this is Sci-Fi Deep Dive. Remember, if you enjoyed this video, to head down below and hit that subscribe button. So, as many of us know, the Rebel Alliance was a small faction. The Rebels didn't nearly have the resources or capability the Empire had at their disposal. So how exactly did the Rebel Alliance actually get the upper hand on the Empire at all? After all, in nearly every battle, the Empire greatly outnumbered the Rebel forces there, and the Rebels had to use keen and interesting tactics to sort of gain any success. So let's start with one of their most prominent and notable tactics. Hit and run strikes. The Rebel Alliance really knew where their advantage was. The Empire was relatively slow to respond to threats. For example, when the Empire was engaged, they usually didn't have fighters out on patrol. They'd have to launch TIE fighters. And while the Empire had devised systems to launch TIE fighters very quickly, it still took at least a little bit of time. So if the Rebels could jump in, hit a target, and get out before the Empire could launch their fighters, Imperial facilities were basically defenseless. This was made even more dramatic by the fact that Imperial facilities generally weren't very well defended against starfighters. A great example of this is the Imperial-class Star Destroyer, the mainline capital ship for the Imperial Navy, which had a pathetic point defense system. And the Rebel starfighters played into this greatly. Unlike Imperial starfighters, which were all relatively cheap TIE fighters, which didn't have hyperdrives or shields, Rebel starfighters were designed to basically carry out these raids entirely on their own, without the need of a base or capital ship. Rebel starfighters all had their own shields and hyperdrives, allowing these starfighters to jump into a system, hit a target, and jump out before the Empire could respond. These quick hit-and-run attacks usually caught the Empire off guard. Only a few Imperial facilities really could hold off an attack like this. Another thing that really played into the Rebels' favor with attacks like this was their intelligence. This part isn't really referenced a lot, although it is mentioned briefly in Return of the Jedi, but the Rebel Alliance had a really remarkable spy network. You see, it turns out that a lot of the galaxy really aren't in favor of the Empire at this point, and many of them are willing to sort of leak information about where Imperial facilities and units are. This meant that the Rebel Alliance was able to quickly and accurately figure out which targets they needed to hit. For example, they could figure out Imperial supply lines and hit supply depots instead of a heavily defended base, thus starving the base of crucial supplies. And when they needed to attack a target that was very heavily defended, like, say, the second Death Star, they would carry out a series of smaller, diversionary attacks to attempt to draw Imperial forces away. After all, unlike the Rebel Alliance, which can work in very concentrated units, the Empire does have to still maintain order across the entire galaxy. So the Rebellion would use things like diversionary strikes to lure Imperial fleets away from key systems so that they could carry out their raids. But what about when the Rebel Alliance were on the defensive? There was a significant period of time after the Battle of Yavin where the Rebel Alliance were just running for their lives from a vengeful Empire. How exactly did the Rebel Alliance maintain their existence during this period of time? This is where their ability to hide in very extreme environments comes in handy. The Rebels had become keen at hiding in outposts and sort of backwater worlds across the galaxy. The Rebellion was able to set up shop on inhospitable worlds like Hoth, for example, where they could sort of lay low while the Empire tried and failed to find them. And when the Empire did find them, their strategies were simple. Try to stall long enough for any key personnel and material to escape off-world before they can be captured. This made life very difficult on the Empire, who had to try to find an enemy that seemed to come out of nowhere, hit them, and then disappear back into the shadows. This is likely why the Empire would begin projects like what we see come to fruition on the Mega-class Dreadnought, which were things like hyperspace tracking, which would allow them to hypothetically track Rebel starfighters fleeing back to the Rebel fleet. But one of the reasons why the Rebellion was able to carry out such successful hit-and-run attacks comes down to the way the Empire managed their fleets and their control over the galaxy. After all, the Empire did have to maintain order basically everywhere. If you want to learn about how the Empire maintained those fleets and handled that command structure, I'll leave a link up here to my video on that. And I want you to let me know down in the comments whether you think these Rebel tactics are really ingenious, or do you think these seem like no-brainers, seeing the circumstance that the Rebellion was under. And if you have anything you want to see me cover in Star Wars, leave it down below in the comments. And last but not least, if you enjoyed this video, head down below, hit the like button, the subscribe button, and the bell icon so you get notified when I upload new videos. So for Sci-Fi Deep Dive, I'm Colin, and I will see you next time.